Thank you, Cindy. That was beautiful. Good morning. Welcome. And my name is Cynthia Gonzalez, and I'm just here to do the welcome and formal moments for you. For anybody that's new, I'm sorry, I'm out of breath. When you're running three services, sorry. Okay, so for anybody that's new here, a special welcome to you. I also want to let you know that if you haven't gotten a bulletin, be good to have one. In your bulletin on the top, you'll see a little cross. And when you see something like that next to a title, that means that we stand to worship God. Also on the back of your bulletin, you will find some announcements. And the people that are on prayer list that are in need of your prayer, we have gotten some news today that Peggy Batten did pass today, or she passed on Friday, and her services will be held tomorrow on Monday at Willow Ridge, I believe. Visitation is at 11, and service will be at 12. If you have a birthday, May, June, or July, we're doing a 3-for-1 since it's so crazy with the summer and the schedules. We will be having a birthday bash on Sunday, June 23rd at 6:30 at the Parsonage. So again, if you have a birthday in May, June, or July, please come for a piece of cake and some good conversation. Also, we are approaching Unite Camp, which is what our youth is going to be doing. It'll be from July 22nd through the 26th. And as many of you know, teenagers eat and drink a lot. So we are open to donations for waters or any kind of drinks, not gallons, preferably just individual containers, and also snacks, small bags of chips or packs of cookies, things like that. They would love to have some snacks on the road. We'll be gone for 5 days, so it'd be nice to have that. Okay, well, other than that, I believe that is it for us. And we'll go ahead and get this for Cooper. Thank you. Again, I'm also your liturgist today. All right, if you can stand as you're able, and do the call of worship. All the bold is a responsive text. Loving Christ, you are a gentle shepherd.
We long to know your will and to live in your way.
Keep us safe and secure in your compassionate hands.
Lead us into new paths of love and service.
As you lead and guide us, touch our hearts and minds in this worship time.
So that our spirits may be refreshed and our lives filled with joy and praise.
Good morning. I'm Cooper Hornbeck. I'm your hymn leader this morning and also the director of the choir for today. Our first hymn is number 378, Amazing Grace, 378, and we're going to sing verses 1, 2, 4, and 6.
Thank you.
please remain standing for affirmation of faith. You can find this on page 884 in your hymnal. We believe in the one God, creator and sustainer of all things, Father of all nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the Savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God, contained in the Old and New Testaments, as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the Church, those who are united in the living Lord, for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God, as the divine were realized in human society and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you today with many needs and things that are just needing something to be answered, God. Lord, we have several people that are within our body that have ailments in their body, and we are requesting that you do a divine intervention and your will be done, God. Lord, we ask so much that you would just come and rest on us, that we might be able to rest in you, God, and in the knowledge and in the fervency of your love, that we can do what you've called us to do. And as we move on with this day and our weeks and our years, let us not toil over the things of tomorrow, for today has enough toils of its own. And help us to realize that you are for us. And God, as we move, we ask that you would move on our behalf and that you would touch us. As we join together in how Jesus prayed, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward? receive them and bless the givers. We love you, Jesus.
Our scripture reading today comes from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4 through 8. In the bulletin, this one is through the English Standard Version. You can read along in your bulletin, or in your, Pew Bible on page 1787. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning once again. I am Chris Gonzalez. I have the pleasure of being the youth minister here and bringing the word today, which I find a great privilege and honor. Go with me to the Lord in prayer before the message. Father, I ask that you would speak today, despite anything that's within me or that has been within me that might not be received. Lord, I ask for your glory to go forward and your word that is true. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, today's title of the message is Love and Monopoly. We go through the 1 Corinthians verse, and it tells us what love is, you know, what the actions that love are, what is required, what happens whenever you actually have true love. It's love and monopoly, though, because a lot of times whenever we look at this, we think of it more of a game of let's get what we can when we can. Because I don't know about you, but I have a couple kids and they love to play board games with me. But not because I do it right. Because sometimes I'll be I'm that dad who will reach over and move their money and put it underneath the board. I didn't steal it, they just can't find it. Or I'll take one of the houses and move it. And it's just a game, so it's all fun. But a lot of times in our society, that is how we treat church. We're going to come and we're going to get what we can, but we kind of have it backwards sometimes in our minds. I come to church, or I'm part of a church, to receive ministry. Now, that is good. To receive something from God, to receive something from His Word is good. But in reality, everyone should be a part of the church to be a minister. Now, I don't mean that you're going to come up here and preach or you're going to lead the music, because that's not always what a minister is. Whenever I first came to the Lord, I asked God, make me an evangelist. And He did, but not the way I thought it was. Because whenever I came to God, I saw people who were preaching and they drove a Bentley, they came in, and sometimes that's good. Sometimes that is a blessing. But when I realized that those individuals were all about themselves and the accolades that they received, I realized it was wrong. But then God made me a real evangelist. And nobody knew about me. And I didn't care. Because it's not about us. I had a conversation with Grayson, who's one of our youth, after my message the other day, and he said something that really, really stuck with me. And it was something so simple. He says, you know what? It's a little bit about us, because God wants us. But it's more about Him because we need Him. Thinking of this love aspect, I think about how God has brought me through many things. And most of you may not know, but at one point in time, I was a drug addict in high school. I overdosed my senior year of high school. And that began a change. But not because I was even really seeking, but I wanted something different because there were so many things going wrong in my life and I didn't know where to turn. And then He woke me up. And I remember thinking, man, He really loves me. Despite all the things that I did to people, to my family, when I say I did things, I hurt people on purpose because that's what I thought I needed to do. I had moments where I would see compassion, but I didn't want any part of it. And when He woke me up, I remember saying, whenever I received the Lord, whenever I decided I was going to start actually doing this or trying it, I remember it was on a Thursday. I hadn't went to church for myself to try and know God to that point. I was drugged to church as a little kid a little bit, and then I had a girlfriend at one point in time who went to church, so I felt like I had to go. So I heard a little bit about Jesus. And I remember thinking, man, there's got to be more. And then I had a situation where a couple of my friends, one of my friends had died, and another friend, he was in a coma. He's actually going to be getting married next week or week after. And I remember sitting there thinking, God, why did you do this to me? Why did you do this to me? And whether you believe I heard from God, but I know I heard from God, and so it doesn't really matter of anybody else's opinion, because I know what I heard, because I was sitting there and He said to me, you keep going the way you're going and you are next. If that's not a wake-up call, I don't know what is. And to keep the story short, He said it twice to me. And I frantically looked around trying to find who was saying it. And I remember, fine, you want this life, you can have it. I don't need it anyway. And I wanted to commit suicide before then. And I'm trying to be as transparent as possible because I am no longer that person. Some of us are struggling with things. We have depression, anxiety, and so some of those are medical conditions, but some of them are put on by our own selfishness because it's not about us as much as it is about Him. And if you call to Him, then He calls back. And you have the opportunity to receive. In most cases, we forget what the process is. I know individuals who have been, you know, what you would consider a saint. They've been in church all their life, but never once had true repentance. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and repent, then I will heal your land. So the fact, if you consider this, the fact that you have a struggle is an evidence that the Holy Spirit is motivating you to resist. The world has no struggle when it comes to doing things lawless. If you don't have God, you don't have a struggle cheating or stealing. And sometimes you do things that we call love, but we don't understand what love is yet in some cases. So it's more passion, because if you have, I like looking at things sometimes that I'm trying to understand the evil of this world, because I don't understand. Now, if I was younger, maybe I would, because I did some things that were not good. When I say I hurt people, I put people in the hospital because of stuff that I was involved in. Later on, I got that opportunity to actually talk to one of the guys that I put in the hospital. He doesn't have any of his own teeth because of what happened in our situation. We had an altercation. And I did martial arts for a while, and I used it. Not in the right way at all. And having this moment with him and seeing that he was so scared of me, I began to weep. And not having any money, really, but I felt like I needed to do something, because I had been in a treatment program where I was actually a group facilitator at Southeast Missouri Behavioral Health. Going through these 12 steps and understanding that when you come to a point whenever you can ask for forgiveness, you should. So I did just that. And I said, hey man, I want to let you know I'm not the same person. I could see you're nervous. He didn't know I was going to be there. He worked with my brother at the time, so he didn't know anything that I was going to be there. We just both happened to take our lunches at the same time. So, and I was working over at Home Depot at the time. And I come in, he's sitting there and just went white as a ghost. But I didn't remember him. And then he gets up, goes to the restroom, and comes back. And I'm like, my brother tells me, do you remember, you know? And he tells me what I did, reminds me what I did. Because when you're in the situation that I was, you have a trouble with memory, because that stuff eats that portion up. And I said to him, I'm not the same. If you need me to pay for this, for all that has happened that's from me, I will. I didn't even ask my wife, because it wasn't about that. It was about offering something that I felt would mend that for him and myself. It's not about getting everything we want. The Bible doesn't say you can have all your wants. It doesn't. It says if it's a need, you shall receive. If you look at the ravens of the field, if you look at the ravens, it says, how much more do I love you? But yet they don't worry for nothing. But you worry yourself to grow taller, but you can't. When you look in a mirror, you can't say, I want to get taller, and it works. No. Just today has enough of its own. You can't worry about that stuff. Now, how do we draw closer to this God? In James chapter 4, verse 8, it says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Now, I had a series that I was working on where I was trying to help the kids in our youth to grow with their own relationship with God. Because one of the things that I've seen in my years of ministry, because I've been doing this for over 20 years, where I see people that they really want more, but they don't know how. So I look at the scripture where it says, Abba, Father. And I had heard a story recently, and it was a man over in Israel. He's speaking Hebrew, and then he switches to English. And the observer's telling the story, and he says, when he was talking, he was doing something spiritual. And he says to his son, go do this. And his son says, yeah, Dad, but in Hebrew. And he goes, no. When we're in this aspect of spirituality, you should address me as Abba, Father. Now, in some places, in some translations, it says it's Daddy God or Daddy Father. It's not really what it means. When you look deeper into it, it means, Father, in obedience, I will. So what is he asking us to do? Father, in obedience, I will. Well, we have to understand that, first of all, God is love. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 15 and 16, it says, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe that the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. This love, if we're thinking about God and we're trying to do what he says, but we have no repentance, the thing is, if you're the same before the cross as you are after the cross, then what did you need the cross for? What did we need it for? If we don't have a change, then your repentance wasn't repentance. It may sound harsh, but I think some people have forgotten that there is a heaven and there is a hell. And if you believe in one and not the other, you're wrong. I'm sorry. Because there is a heaven. Otherwise, what are we doing this for? Why are we trying to move and help people just to help people? That is good. Helping people is good, and that is a way of showing God's love, because that's what God wants. But what he wants is obedience. We just sang it. We sing it in two different songs. We're obedient to you, and that is how, one way that we can show that we actually love God is to be obedient. So, if I ask my kids to do something, and they look at me and they roll their eyes, but guess what they do? They do what I requested. Not just because I asked them to do it, but because we have that love. And I didn't tell this story in an earlier service, but this is what has been impressed on me right now. It was the first time I realized that God truly loves us. I had been ministering over in Colorado, and I broke my leg on a mountain. And I was upset. I couldn't work. I actually lost my job. And we had a house, we had little kids, and I was scared because I didn't know what to do. So all I could do is cry out to God. And before I knew it, people were calling me and they were saying, hey, here's this money I owed you from like 6 years ago. And God performed a miracle in those moments because we didn't get kicked out of our house. And in that time, my oldest daughter, who I'm going to give her a little bit of praise because she has done something that I never thought I could do, she became a valedictorian. And it was hard, but she pushed through and made it. So I'm so proud. But when she was a baby, when I say a baby, she was actually a toddler. She's still my baby. I was sitting there and my leg was all wrapped up and I couldn't move and I was just kind of wallowing in self-pity. And out of nowhere, she comes up and she sits in my lap. She just looks up. And all of a sudden, this overwhelming sense of just love. Like, it felt like God had replaced my heart with his for that moment. And I realized what true love is. Because in that moment, I knew there was nothing I wouldn't do for her and for all of my kids. Now, I use her as an example because I was young, immature, and that's one of those moments that I had been praying, God, I need something from you. Again, the Bible says, if it's a need, you will receive. If you are in God, then he is in you. And he loves us more than anything. He doesn't have to have us, guys. He does not have to have us. He already created beings before us. And he threw a third of them out. That's what hell is actually for. Hell is for them. Because the Bible says he doesn't want us to go to hell. It says that he would not want any of us to be there and feel condemned. So he's not sending us. That's where we get it wrong in a lot of cases. He's not sending us because he wants to and he's mad at us. He's sending us because he will respect your choice. If you choose not to abide in God, then he'll choose to let you go. But he'll pursue you until the point when you're past no return. So if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and repent, then I will heal your land. Jesus, he even forgave sins while he was alive. He didn't have to. He broke man's law to prove that God can do anything despite the circumstances. This week, we had an opportunity. Cynthia got to go up there, and Tim was requested to go lead worship for a camp over at Camp Allen. And there was a guy there who I'd actually seen preach before. And he gives his testimony because he was out hunting and he was about 22, 24 feet up in the tree. And he falls out and he lands square on his shoulders. And as he's laying there, he can't feel anything from his chest down. And his first thought was, oh, Lord, I need you. Please. And then he reaches in his pocket and he has no service because he's over in the middle of nowhere in Malden in the woods on his property. And he calls his wife a minute after his prayer. And he says, honey, I'm sorry, but I think this is it. I think I'm going to die. And she says, no, you're not. No, you're not. God is going to do something right now. And her faith is what made this happen. Because he was like, I don't know. It doesn't feel right. And some of it I can't feel. So got off the phone. They called 911. It took 11 minutes for them to get a hold of 911 between that conversation. And just so happened to be an air evac helicopter happened to be flying towards the area. And so in 24 minutes time, he was receiving treatment for his body. He doesn't have his own backbone. He has a femur in the middle of his back. And I was sitting there and I was like, God, it doesn't even look like he has any pain. And if you guys don't know, for the last several years, 5, 6 years, or 7 years, I've been in chronic pain because of my back. I've had to have surgery. They wanted me to get 2 other surgeries. And I told them no. Because I can bear it. I can manage it. So for 5 years straight, I've been on medication to deal with this. And I was looking at him and I was like, it looks like he doesn't have any pain. So I asked him. Because in my mind, I really wanted him to pray for me. And I wanted to have the opportunity the first day I seen him, but we didn't get that. And on Monday, I was there again, still didn't get it. On Tuesday, things just kind of erupted in there, and it was a really cool time. But after that, he was tired, and he left before I could even talk to him. Plus, we had to get home because I had to work. I'm doing security over at the high school right now for the summer school. So I had to be up there at 7 o'clock in the morning. And I have to get up at 5 because of how far I live out. So I didn't get that opportunity. So I was like, on the last day, I'm going to talk to him. And we had conversations, but it wasn't ever about what I wanted. And so I went over there and sat down before anybody else could. And I just asked him, hey, how do you have any pain? And he goes, glory to God, I don't. This man has a femur bone and 13 rods and screws in his back. And I was like, man, I want that. I don't have all the hardware he does. I still have or had pain because I was hoping that after I talked to him, we would just get done eating. We would go out by ourselves and have a conversation and pray. Didn't happen. Well, we're in the middle of this worship service and the service in general, he just finished preaching and we're up there playing again. And then at one point they're like, hey, if these kids want to come up and worship with you guys. And so I was like, okay, because it's not about me. And they wanted to give God glory with their talents as well. So I'm sitting here playing a keyboard. And I was like, here, I'll set it up for you. So I set it up. And I gave my microphone to the other girl. And I just walked away over to the side of the stage. The man was right there next to me, and I was like, okay, maybe. But then he was praying, so I was like, not yet, not now. And so I just kind of started worshiping, closed my eyes, and was just thanking God. And what I missed is before the service, I got upset because there's been a lot of times I've had people pray for me, and I know the word says that He can heal. And I've seen it happen. I've seen people who are in wheelchairs get up and walk. And it's not because of the person, but it's because of the glory of God and what they would receive by seeing this and being a part of it. So I said, Father, Forgive me for my unbelief. Help me to get rid of the things that are separating this so that your power can be shown within me. Because God, I don't know how long I can go taking this medication, and I know it does damage to your body. I don't want to be on it. I've been struggling with it for the last 2 years, trying to figure out a way to get off of it. And most of the time they're like, well, we can just switch your medication. But I didn't want to be on medication. Now, I'm not saying that's a bad thing. That's just my personal thing. But because I know that God loves each one of us, and when it's a need and we come in the right way, he'll meet it. And so he prays for me. And it's just a real simple prayer. Lord Jesus, heal his body. We request right now. And you know what I felt right there in that moment? Absolutely nothing. I didn't feel anything. I didn't feel any tingling, prayer, like anything. I was like, okay, just another time. But that's okay, God. Not my will, but your will be done. If your will is for me to walk with this pain so that I can bear it as a testimony, I'll do it. And we didn't get home until 2 o'clock, 1:30. I think I got to bed around 2:30. Had to get up at 5 and get to work. I was tired, but we made it through. It was a really good day. Because when I woke up that morning, I had no pain. Nothing. I didn't understand. Because the times that I had seen it, it happened instantly. And I was like, is it real? I remember being in the shower and thinking, man, I really don't feel any pain. And so in the morning, I take medication so that I can make sure that I can walk. Because sometimes if my pain is unbearable, it swells my disc so bad that it cuts off my right leg and I cannot move my right leg. I'll drag it, or I might take smaller steps. So, glory to God, I didn't take any medication. And then having worked for a treatment center and also having withdrawals from my addiction that was previous, I know that the medication I was on, I was going to have a withdrawal. There's no way I couldn't, because I've been on that stuff for 5 years. And what happened is yesterday I woke up with a headache. Then I started having these body aches. It wasn't hurting in my back, but they were aching everywhere else. And I remember, I was like, I need to do something. I need to take one. I need to do this, telling myself this. And so before I did it, though, I called my wife. I said, sweetheart, I was on my way home driving. I was like, I'm starting to have withdrawals. I said, if it gets any worse, I'm probably going to have to go to the hospital, because that's the only way that I know to get off this medication and not have the symptoms. Because when I did the withdrawals before, you've never felt any feeling like that, to be cold on the outside but fire on the inside. Your skin's crawling like you haven't slept in days. And that had started. But she said, babe, it's okay. You've got this. She talked me off of the ledge a little bit, because I still wasn't convinced. And then when I called my friend and I said, dude, I'm starting to have this. I have had a headache all day. I need something. He says, but I'm struggling because I don't want to go through this. He says, it's okay. You're not supposed to go through it. It's not something, if God did a healing, both of them said the same exact words verbatim. If God did a healing, you have to believe him for this too. And this morning when I woke up, I didn't have any withdrawal symptoms. And I believe that was a test. Going back to that father in obedience, I will. Because in my heart, I knew I wasn't supposed to. But in my mind, I was telling myself I had to. And I'm saying this as a testimony to God's glory, because again, it's just something that I was happened to be able to receive. And that's for each one of us who are in God. We're showing that love that he has for us to all people, despite their sin. It is not our job to cause people to repent. It's our job to present Jesus and his love and his grace and his mercy. You give them the options, they make the decision. Because, again, if you're the same person before the cross as you are after the cross, then you didn't need the cross. But the cross is for us. That sacrifice is love. And I struggle so much with actually bringing something that kind of sounds harsh. But it's true. It is more true today for me than it has ever been. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and repent, then I'll heal your land. We want this place to grow. We want our gospel, the gospel of Christ, to actually go forward. Then we have some things that we have to do, because the Bible says faith without works is dead. And love is an action. Because if I tell my wife that I love her, but I don't ever show it, I don't ever even so much as give her a hug, then I don't love her. I've seen that happen. And their relationships don't last, or it ends super, super terrible. But that's not what God has for us. Now, as you're thinking about what you have going on within yourself, the things that you're struggling with, you can confess that to God, and He will forgive you. But again, it's not about us as much as it is about Him receiving glory. Because if you keep that stuff for yourself, and it's about selflessness, not selfishness. And it doesn't matter your sin, because God can forgive all sin. But if you go back to that sin, sorry, it's a cycle. But that's why it says to those who are being saved, because it's a process, it's an action process. It's not just a one and done. It's one of those things where you repent and you receive once you believe. That's how simple it is. But a lot of times we're like, well, if I go over here and do this, or if I go over here and do this, and I serve and I do this, I'm a good person, God. None of that matters. Because I'm here to tell you, there are murderers in heaven. because they've repented and believed and they changed. May not like that. Maybe I'll use a less sin. There are people who go out and steal packs of gum regularly. And he forgives them too. Because he wants us so much. So I'm going to pray, and we're going to finish out. One thing I want to say is no matter what, God loves each and every one of us. But he requires something of us to be able to make that connection. So Father, I thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for who you are. And help us to push in the direction that your will guides us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for that wonderful sermon, Chris. It was such an honor to hear it twice. Yes. Would you please stand with me and sing our closing hymn? We're going to be singing number 408, The Gift of Love. We're just going to be singing the first verse, number 408.
Father, as we go out today into this world, help us to show the love that you have shown us. God, that we can be repented people that are connected with you. And that we, as we go forward, bring those connections and harbor your body. We love you, we praise you, and we give you all the glory, for you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.